Good morning, everybody. Would you all stand and let's sing this together? Well, good morning, everybody. Welcome to church. My name's Sierra, and I have the privilege of being on staff here. We're going to sing a couple more songs today. We'll hear a message, and service will be about an hour long. Psalm 149:3 says this, "Let them praise his name with dancing and make music to him with timbrel and harp." And that word praise is actually one of the seven different words in the Hebrew language for praise. And it means, the word is halal, and that means to celebrate, to rave, to be loud or clamorous, and to act foolishly. It's a pretty bold physical expression of worship, and it's actually the most commonly used word for praise in the Hebrew language. Halal is what you would do when you're celebrating your favorite sports team's win, or if you go to your favorite concert, or you're at a wedding reception and you're just dancing, you're so excited to be there. That is halal. And halal is also the word that makes up the word hallelujah, which I'm sure we're all fairly familiar with, which means halal yah, which is to celebrate God, praise God, to celebrate what he has done and who he is in response to God, to act madly in response to God. So this morning, as we come and remember Jesus, let's also come and celebrate what he's done for us. Let's remember what he has done and then celebrate that in this time where we get to come together and sing these songs. So would you join me and participate as much as you feel comfortable, and let's sing this out together. Walls that we called sin and shame, they were like prisons that we couldn't escape. But he came, and he died, and he rose. Those walls are rubble now. Remember those giants we called dead. Like mountains that stood in our way, but he came and he died and he rose. Those giants are dead now. This is our God, this is who he is, he loves us. This is our God, this is what he does, he saves us. He bore the cross, is our God, King Jesus. Remember that fear that took our breath away. Faith so weak that we could barely pray. But he heard every word, every whisper. Now those altars story of his faithfulness. Never once did he fail, and he never will. This is our God, this is who he is, he loves us. This is our God, this is what he does, he saves us. He bore the cross, beat the grave. Sin, nobody but Jesus. Who pulled me out of that pit? He did, he did. Who paid for all of our sin? Nobody but Jesus. Who rescued me from that grave? Yahweh, Yahweh. Who gets the glory and praise? Nobody but Jesus. Rescue me from that grave, Yahweh, Yahweh. else would rocks cry out to worship? Whose glory taught the stars to shine? Perhaps creation longs to have the words to sing, but this joy is mine. With a thousand hallelujahs, we magnify your name. You alone deserve the glory, the honor, and the praise. Lord Jesus, this song is forever. This song is forever yours. A thousand hallelujahs and a thousand more. Lord Jesus, we glorify you this morning. We thank you that we have something to celebrate in you, God. We thank you for the freedom that you offer and the joy that you bring. It's in your name we pray. Amen. Amen. Thanks so much for singing with us. You can go ahead and take a seat.
Good morning, everyone. Welcome to church. My name is Rachel, and I have the privilege of serving on the team here this morning. When you came in through the doors, you were handed this program. Go ahead and take that out with me right now. You'll find some really great things in there, like message notes for today, as well as on the inside, a QR code that will take you to our virtual connection card. Go ahead and take out your phone, take a picture of that QR code, and start filling out that card. We ask everyone every week to fill this out, whether you are a regular around here or a guest, because two really great things happen when you fill out this card. The first is that for every card filled out every single weekend, we get to make a donation in your honor to an organization called Living Water. Living Water helps provide clean, sustainable drinking water to developing nations all across the globe. So just for filling out this card today, you are making a difference. And the second thing is that it gets you connected here at Eastpoint. You have an opportunity to request more information about things going on, as well as leave prayer requests so that our prayer team can be praying for you throughout the week. While you fill out that card, I want to bring your attention to a couple things coming up. Next Sunday, we have new service times. It's daylight saving time next weekend, so for you guys, that doesn't really change anything, but our new service time will be at 10 a.m. We're moving to one service, one church under one roof for a season so that we can really come together and get to know the people in our church. And I'm really excited about this and most looking forward to all of the new friends that you're going to meet next week when you realize there's someone at the other service that sits in the exact same space as you here in this room. You're going to meet your new best friend next weekend. So be excited. Look forward to that. Next Sunday, 10 a.m., one service. Invite a friend to join you. It's going to be great. And after the one service next week, we are having our Starting Point gathering. You can register for that if you are new to Eastpoint or newer to Eastpoint. This is an opportunity for you to learn about the nuts and bolts of Eastpoint, what makes Eastpoint Eastpoint, and decide if Eastpoint is your church home. So register for that if you haven't already. It's next Sunday after the one service. We'd love to have you with us. You can register on the app or in your program. You can find some more info about how to sign up online as well. Well, we're going to put a timer on the screen for you as you continue to fill out that connection card and Tony makes his way for today's talk. Let's go for it.
Question for you. How many of you are, you can show your hands, okay? So lift your hands up and ask for a little bit of participation with you. If you're online, maybe you can click the like button or something. But how many of you would say you're dating or you would like to be dating? Just by show of hands. If you're married, you can say, I'm dating. I hope you're dating. Okay. So a few more hands go up, okay? How many of you, by show of hands, how many of you, let's get a little bit personal. How many of you ever, you don't have to tell the story, but how many of you have ever had a bad first date? You've had a bad first date. Okay. Quite a few of you. How many of you are still sitting with that person? This is your first date. You took me serious last week when you're like, I swiped on someone, invited them to church. How many of you have ever, just by show of hands, you've fallen in love? Okay, lots of hands up. How many of you have ever had your heart broken? Oh, that's sad. we all have. Okay, last question, show of hands. How many of you are single? Go ahead and look around. Maybe take notice. I'm just kidding. But here's the thing is we've been doing this series called For Better, For Worse, and we've been talking everything about relationships and marriage. And today we're going to specifically talk a little bit more about dating. Next week we're going to talk about divorce. But dating as a whole, and so if you're married today, look at it through the lens of like, I should probably still be dating my spouse, okay? And there's some things that you can still take away from today. And just like last couple of weeks when Joe was here and we talked about marriage. In fact, if you missed one of those weeks, and you can go back online and watch one, they're fantastic to help us have the marriages that we really want, to have the marriage that you thought you were gonna have when you first said, I do, right? But, you know, so if you're dating and you're not married and you come through those talks, you're like, I don't really know how to always this applies to me. And so today's for you. Today, I want you to lean in as someone, maybe you're single and dating or you'd like to be dating, or if you're in a relationship or you are married, date your spouse, okay? It's just, there's a lot you can still apply, but dating is really difficult. It's like, it can be awesome and it can be awful, right? It can like have this high highs and low lows. In fact, there's a comedian, one of my favorites, Taylor Tomlinson, and she gives this example of dating. She talks about like how we're filled with these high highs and low lows, how we have these like so much hope, but then also so much disappointment. And she relates it to how like an animal being a stuffed animal be like in one of those like claw machines at an arcade, how you're just sitting there, you're just waiting for the right person to come along and like find you, and then it's like, oh no, didn't happen. And it's like, okay, could it be? Oh no, man, I can't believe I actually told people about that one. And then you're like, oh, you just wanted to move me over here to get to something else. Okay, I get it. I'm fine. I'll be fine. You know, dating is so, it's difficult. And if you've been in a relationship for a while, or you've been married for a while, you might forget some of it. As someone that is kind of newer to the dating world, I was married for a number of years and then divorced, and like now dating, like it's awful. I mean, it's great. It's so fun. That was a little too honest sometimes. It's so great, but it's also so, it can be just difficult to manage, and it's filled with a lot of heartbreak and a lot of like great expectation and great disappointment and all these different things. So I just want you to know that you're not alone if you're in the dating world. And we're going to jump right in, okay? Two myths about dating. In fact, I would encourage you to take out your program, and you got notes in there. But we're going to talk about two myths of dating. And once you surface a myth like this, you look at it and be like, well, yeah, that's pretty ridiculous. Like, but these myths that we're going to talk about today, they actually kind of sit as an undercurrent to our thinking and to our assumptions about relationships. In fact, these myths are really unexplored assumptions that we bring into our relationships. They are these unexplored assumptions. And anytime you have these unexplored assumptions in any area of life, financially, business, whatever it is, whatever you do, what happens is these unexplored assumptions, they will actually inform your decisions. And when they're unexplored and you don't know why you believe the things that you believe or why you operate the way you operate, what happens is oftentimes we don't even know that these things are informing our decisions, and we end up making some really bad decisions. So my hope today is that these myths, as we bring them to light, we can look at them and be like, oh, yeah, that's ridiculous. And we can also be honest with ourselves and say, I can see how that myth has actually impacted and influenced my life. I can see how I've believed that myth, and that's informed. I didn't know it, but that actually informed a lot of my decisions. And so these two relational myths, that's what they do. They inform our decisions. We learn them from culture. We learn them from the lives around us. Like, culture fuels these myths. But as soon as you see them, as soon as you hear them, you're gonna be like, oh yeah, I get it. Those aren't true. But yet again, if we're honest with ourselves, we'd say they're not true, but they really have fueled my assumptions and my decisions that I made. So here it is. Here's number one, and you can write this down. Here's myth number one. It's the right person myth. The right person myth is this, that it's not that there's not a right person for you, but the right person myth is that once you meet the right person, everything will be all right. Once you meet the right person, yeah, and if you're married, you just shook your head and be like, that ain't true. Once you meet the right person, everything will be all right. That everything's just going to be fine. If you just meet the right person, regardless of what you do between now and then of meeting the right person, everything, once I meet that person, it will be just fine. So right now in life, I can play, I can mess around, I can fool around, I can treat guys this way, I can treat girls this way. It doesn't really matter what I do right now, because once I just meet the right person, everything will just settle down, everything will change, I will change, and everything will be all right. My past disappears, my blunders in relationship disappear, my bad habits disappear, all these things just change, because hey, I finally found the right person. And so what happens though if you've already found the right person and you moved in with them, or you found the right person and you married them, and now you're at a season in your life, you're like, well, things just don't seem like they're all right. What do you do with that? And you're slowly coming to the conclusion that, again, that's what culture teaches us. You're coming to the conclusion that you must have chosen the wrong right person. That this person, I thought they were the right person, must have been the wrong right person. They must be right for somebody else, but they're no longer right for me. And now you're looking out for who? Who are you looking out for now? You're looking for the next right person. We just like, and when I say it this way, it sounds ridiculous. And you can say, yeah, that's obviously a myth, right? But if we're honest with ourselves, this type of thinking, it fuels our relationship decisions. And oftentimes it informs the direction that we go in our relationships, because we believe into this idea, this myth and culture that says, hey, if I'm unhappy, I just must not be with the right person. If I'm unhappy, they must be the wrong person for me. If you're unhappy, you must be with the wrong person. You need to go find the new right person. If you can just find the right person, then everything is going to be all right. And it's a myth. It's a myth that once you find them, everything will be just fine. It's a myth that once you find the right person, everything will be all right. And here's the deeper part of the myth, if we're being honest with ourselves. We also believe that if I can just find the right person, everything will be fine, including me. If you can just find the right person, everything will be fine, including you. Because, hey, you know what? If I can just find the right person, all those bad habits that I have, they'll go away. If I can just find the right person, the things I struggle with, the addictions that I have, the poor decisions I make, those will just go away. Because, hey, I found the right person, and they're going to help me manage it, or I'm not going to need that anymore. I'm not going to want that anymore, because the right person just changed me overnight. Like, it just changed me who I was and who And the idea that the myth is that if I just find the right person, that not just everything will be all right, but it's that I will also be all right. If I just find the right person, this myth even fuels our fantasies. Let me explain. When you fantasize about like what if or if only, man, you think about like the future, like maybe you think backwards actually relationships, like only if I would have just stuck it out with that one person, I think they were the right person for me. And you actually hold on to this ideal that there's this person from your past, like if only, what if? And you think about your future, like if only I could just find the right person, if I could find the person that like looks like this or acts like this or makes this amount of money, and you fantasize about these things, about what if, only if I could, right? Here's what we don't fantasize about. We don't fantasize about us becoming a better person. We fantasize just about finding the better person, finding the right person. And it's a myth, and you know it, because there's so much more to it. There's more to a satisfying relationship than finding or ever being found. We just don't really hear much about this. We don't hear much about it because it doesn't make for great television, it doesn't make for great TV, it doesn't make for great movies, right? Yeah, like when you think about what makes great reality TV and great movies is things like the show Love is Blind. Any Love is Blind fans out there? We are literally watching a show where they're trying to find the right person without even seeing them. That sounds awesome. They're not based on looks, just based on getting to know them. But it's still based on the idea, if I just find the right person. Rom-coms, I love rom-coms. Rom-coms, it's funny, when you watch them, it's like you can see the whole storyline because they're so predictable, right? You can see like these two people just need to be together. It takes them like an hour and 45 minutes to figure it out, something that you knew the whole time. But then they finally do, and then they get to the end, and what happens? The movie's over, and they're together, right? And happily ever after, of course, right? Little like secret time with Tony for a second, okay? I'm gonna admit something to you. I'm not proud of this, okay? Don't judge me. I'm not proud of this, but I wanted to share some honest moment with you, is that I love stories. Like, so when it comes to movies that I watch, I love rom-coms, but not just rom-coms. I love like the dramas. Like, I love the Nicholas Sparks stuff too, okay? And I'm not gonna go read the book, but I'll watch the movie, okay? And when I was going through my divorce, these were like the only movies that I could really watch. I do love like action movies and war and violence and superhero stuff, right? Like, yeah, like I'm a man, you know. But during this time, the only things that I could really stomach was these like romantic comedies or dramas. That's all I could really watch. And again, and I'm not proud of this. I'm not happy that I'm admitting this to you today, but it's secret time with Tony. And is that there was one movie this is one of my favorite movies. And during this season of my life, it's like I watched it on repeat many, many, many times. And it's this, Sweet Home Alabama. Okay, I loved this movie. But here's why this movie, I think, stood out to me during the season is because if you've seen this movie, you know, like they find love when they're young and then life kind of separates them and some things happen. But while they're apart, the dude, he works on himself. And he has goals and he has dreams and he has aspirations, but he hunkers down and he works on himself. He starts a business. He's successful. He's disciplined. He's a man of his word. He stays true to who he is and he works on him. And I knew that I was going to be entering into the dating world, and I needed to make sure I was working on me. And there were things that I needed to grow in, things that I needed to mature in, things that I needed to learn about myself. And for a year and a half, I went to counseling almost every single week. I still go, but I knew that there were some things that I just needed to work on for Tony, because I knew that I could fall in love again one day, but I also wanted to be somebody that was worth loving. And not like, oh, poor Tony, not like that. I wanted to be somebody, let's be honest, in a relationship that was worth committing to, was going to be worth being accountable to, that I could also contribute and be counted on in a relationship. And I had some room to grow, and I still have some room to grow. There's things that we need to do for ourselves. The reality is like falling in love is the easy part, right? You know what it requires to fall in love? A pulse, okay? Like, if you have a pulse, you can fall in love. Falling in love is the easy part, but staying in love requires so much more. And that's what this whole series has really been about. So there's the first myth, is the right person myth. The second myth is this, it's the promise myth. The promise myth, write that down in your notes. The promise myth is a myth that maintains that basically when it comes to a satisfying long-term relationship, that all we need to do is make a promise. If we just make a promise, that when it comes to relationships, this is the myth, this is what it teaches us, that when it comes to a relationship, promise actually replaces the need for preparation. That a promise will replace the need for preparation. It's the idea that you can commit, you can promise, you can vow your way into a healthy, successful, long-term, mutually satisfying relationship. That you can promise, you can commit, you can vow into a successful future with somebody. Which when you say it like that, you say, like, that's pretty ridiculous. You can't promise your way into that. To think that somehow everything that came before, everything you've done, everything that makes you to who you are in that moment, that day, on that, when you make that promise, what happens is really on one day you make a promise and you throw a party, right? You stand before friends and family, you go to an altar and you make a promise before God. You promise to do all these things and to be this type of person, and then you throw a good party, and then they're just happily ever after, right? Somehow your past disappears. You're a brand new person. You're a different kind of person because, hey, you made a promise. But promises, and you know this, again, when you surface myths like this, you realize, like, this is pretty ridiculous. Promises are never a substitute for preparation. Promises are never a substitute for preparation. Like, we know this in every other arena of life except relationships. We know this in academics, right? You can't promise your way to a degree. You actually have to do the work. You have to show up. You have to study. You have to do the homework. You have to turn in the reports. You have to do all the things that in the world of sports and business and medicine, like, you can't promise your way to a win. You can't promise your way to success, right? There's no college basketball coach or no college football coach that would ever, like, bring the guys in the locker room, like, all right, huddle around, boys. Go ahead and take a knee. Everyone just take a knee. Yep. Okay, I see y'all. All right, here's what we're going to do today. As we head out to the game, we're going to win. You know how I know we're going to win? It's because right now, we're all going to make a promise that we're going to win. You just look at each other and say, I promise we're going to win. I promise. You promise? You all promise? All right, we're going to win today, right? Nobody does that. Maybe the Mariners, because they just don't win, but nobody does that. It doesn't happen, right? Because you know that practice, coaches know that practice is how you will win games. There's a need for preparation. You can't promise your way into winning. So what do? You have to prepare to win. This is true in your relationships. But who teaches you to prepare? Who teaches us to prepare for relationships? Not very many. And what happens is a byproduct of culture and a byproduct of all the things we intake into our life, we're just told that if you can just meet the right person, everything's going to be all right. And it's a myth. And the whole idea that you don't have to prepare for something to win, that you can just promise your way, it's a myth. And this is tough to say, but when it comes to relationship, commitment's probably way overrated. Commitment's probably way overrated. And let me say it like this, because you can't say, or like to say I do, to take the vows and say I do, it doesn't mean you can. You can make the commitment, but how do you actually follow through? How do you live up to it? How do you not let things happen in your relationship that get toxic? How do you not keep going back to those same wells of bad habits and addictions? How do you not hurt somebody else? I do doesn't mean that you can. In fact, you know this because you've been to weddings, right? You've been to weddings. Maybe you can think of a time when you went to a wedding. Maybe you're even with your date or with your spouse and you're in the back of the room and you see that young couple up there and you look at them like, you remember when we were that young and dumb? Remember when we were in that stage? Remember when everything was easier? Everything was like, you remember that? And they're up there, and they're cute, and they're doing their thing, and they wrote their own vows, and so they say all the, like, I'll love you forever, you're my sweetness, you know, all these like silly things that they say, and they mean, and you're like, that's cool, I really hope that for them. And then the groom, all of a sudden, he like surprises the bride, and he steps back, and he grabs his friend's guitar, and he pulls it out. He's like, yeah, baby, I'm gonna love you forever. And he just pauses, he starts strumming. And I swear by the moon and the stars in the sky, I'll be there. That's for you, babe. And I swear like the shadow that's by, you didn't know you were gonna get a show today, by your side, I'll be there. Here's the name of the series, for better or worse. Let me hear you. Death do us part. I'll love you with every beat of my heart. I swear. Yeah. What is that? It's a promise. It's a promise. And promises are powerful until they're not lived up to. And that's when we get hurt. Promises are powerful until they're not lived up to. And I'm not trying to be negative. Okay, I think relationships and love and marriage is fantastic. My goal is not to be negative, but most couples that are going into marriage, they're not prepared. And they're not prepared because there are some conversations that they haven't fully been honest about yet. And they're not prepared because they haven't dealt with some of their bad habits and their addictions yet. And they're not prepared because they've never done a budget. And they're not prepared, and some of the things they're not prepared are out of their control, but most of them, if they just hunker down and do the work and do the preparation and be honest with themselves and reflect and work on themselves, right? Like, you're like, oh, that was a great ceremony. That was a great promise. It was a fantastic party. Thanks for the free drinks. I hope you guys, I'm sure you're going to do it, you know? But are we prepared? And you don't vow your way into a successful future relationally. You have to prepare. Listen, especially if you've never been married before, saying I do, this is in your notes, or you should write this down, this one's not in your notes. Saying I do does not make you capable. Saying I do makes you accountable. Saying I do, it doesn't make you capable. It means that you are accountable. And guess what? When you are accountable but not capable, you're miserable. Okay, so when you are accountable, but you're not capable, you're like, I committed to this, I made a promise, I'm stuck in this, I don't want to get out of this, I don't know how to, but I just, this is so hard, it's harder than I thought, and I don't know how to fix it, I don't know what to do, I don't know how to move forward, I'm not capable. And when you're accountable, but not capable, you end up miserable. So here's a brilliant statement, okay, this is worth writing down. Here it is: if you aren't preparing, you won't be prepared. Yeah, I know. Okay, I'll probably need to explain this one, so let's look at it again. I'll go slow. If you're not preparing, if you're dating and you're not preparing, if you're married and you're not working on yourself, you're not prepared. You won't be prepared. And again, you recognize this is just common sense, but I'm telling you, when it comes to relationship, when it comes to dating, common sense is not all that common. And there's some work and effort that we need to put into it. I want you to be prepared. And for those of you that are in a relationship or you're married, I want you to even know that you can still start this. It's not too late to restart this, to work on yourself, to the person that you said yes to, the person that you made that promise to, that you made that commitment to. And you're wondering, like, it's difficult now because of kids and work and money and busyness and whatever it is, and things aren't as you thought they would be, and it's difficult, and you're wondering, can we fix this? Of course you can. And I know there's some things out there that are outliers that are not very fixable, or there's some real hurt and some real pain and some real abuse or trauma, things that are, like, I'm not going to those extremes that unfortunately are all too common. I'm going to the things that just the turmoil, the tension, the problems that we face in marriage, that there are some things that they're completely fixable, but you don't fix it by just saying, if I could just fall in love with them all over again, because that was the easy part. It's the work that's the hard part. It's the preparation, and it's the working on you. You can't work on them anyway, so stop trying, okay? Like, work on you. There's a way forward, and it begins with you. Now, this is where in the message that Jesus comes in and comes really alive here for us. This is honestly where following Jesus makes all the difference right now in this world, right? Like following Jesus in your life, in your current context, in your current relationship or your future relationships, this is huge. This makes a big difference and a big deal. You may have heard me say something like this, that following Jesus will make your life better and following Jesus will make you better at life. I believe that. Following Jesus will make your life better and following Jesus will make you better at life. So the same thing, we can tweak that a little bit and say it like this. We can say it like this. We can say following Jesus will make your relationships better and following Jesus will make you better at relationships. He just will. You can say yes to following Jesus. And the reason why I know this is because Jesus leaves us with this magnificent relational principle that is so powerful. It's so defining. It's kind of really the driving force behind all the stuff that we've been teaching throughout this series. But Jesus, he invites us to follow him. And you can start to follow him before you ever even put your trust and faith that he is Lord, that he is the Son of God. And even if without that declaration of faith, just choosing to follow Jesus and these principles, this one specific principle will make you better at relationships and will make your relationships better. If we could just do this. See, here's the thing is that following Jesus will help you become the kind of person. In fact, let's put it on the screen here. Following Jesus will help you become the kind of person that you are looking for, is looking for. Following Jesus will help you become the kind of person that you are looking for. You're looking for somebody. You're looking for Mr. Right, Mrs. Right. Following Jesus will help you become the kind of person that you're looking for, is looking for. So it brings us to this question, and it's for all of us, whether you're married, single, or you're divorced, your students, your graduates, whatever season of life you are in, are you the person? Are you the person that you are looking for, is looking for? Are you the person that you are hoping for, are you the person that they are hoping for? Or do you have some work to do? Which the truth is, we do. Are you the kind of person that you are looking for, is looking for? And Jesus says, I want you to follow me and you will become. Follow me and I want to bring transformation to your life. Follow me and I'm going to help you curve off those bad habits. Follow me and I'm going to help you get free from addiction. Follow me and I'm going to help you transform and become the person that you are looking for, is looking for. So if you're married, here's your version. If you're married, are you still the person that they were looking for? Are you still the person that they were hoping for? When you entered into a relationship and the person that they thought they were promising themselves to, the person they thought they were entering a relationship or marriage to, are you still becoming the person they thought they were uniting themselves with? If you're single, here's your version. Are you becoming the type of person that you'd hope to find? Do you hope to find a person with your current bad habits? Do you hope to find a person with your types of addictions? Do you hope to find that person, right? Do you hope to find, oh yeah, but I won't worry. None of that matters because if I can just find the right person, everything will be all right, wrong. If I can just promise myself the right person, then I won't do those things anymore, wrong. Like these are the myths that we buy into. These are the myths that we believe in. It's so easy to get sidetracked and buy into these myths. And Jesus has invited us to follow him. In fact, in John's gospel, John was one of Jesus' closest friends, and John writes, gives this eyewitness account, the life, teachings, message, death, resurrection of Jesus. And in John's gospel, he gives us this story about Jesus. At one point, he's sitting down with his closest friends. He's sitting down with his disciples, and he says, hey, I want you to remain in me like a branch like stays stuck into a tree trunk. I want you to draw life from me. I want you to bear fruit because of the source of life that comes from. I want you to remain in me like a branch into the trunk of a tree. Not by finding the right person or not by drawing life from the other person, but I want you to draw life from me, through me. And so Jesus gives us this interaction to remain in him and to do things his way. In fact, this is where we're going to read in John 15. It says this. These are Jesus' words. He says, if you keep my commands and obey my teaching, you will remain in my love. And here's what happens. Jesus says, here's what happens when you do this. The next verse. I have told you these things so that my joy and delight may be in you and that your joy may be made full and complete. Wow. Yeah, that's what I want. I want that joy. I want that delight. I want Jesus, I want to be complete in you. I want to be enough in you, that sounds good. So what do I need to do, Jesus? I need to keep your commands. Okay, I kind of know what the commands are. And you're thinking maybe even what the first hearers would have heard when they heard the story from Jesus' lips. They're thinking of the commands. Okay, like what the command? Like the Big Ten? Like the Ten Commandments? Okay, I think I know a few of those. I could probably do those commands. But then Jesus keeps talking, and he says this. He says, my command is this. Oh, whoa, Jesus, I thought I knew what the commands were, but you're telling me something new. Okay, I guess I'll lean in here. This seems important to you, Jesus, so it's important to me too. I want to know what's your command, Jesus. And he keeps going. He says, my command is this, love each other as I have loved you. To love each other as I have loved you. Jesus, why is this important? Because Jesus sets the standard on love. You don't, he says, love each other the way your mama loved you growing up. Love each other the way you've experienced love. Love each other the way that you wish you were loved. Love each other. And some of you are like, well, I just know I saw the way my parents did it, and they were awful at it, and they were at each other's throats. They were like roommates in the house, and I'm going to do it differently. So I define love differently because I just want to define love by not what my parents did. Or I want to define love because I have this idea because someone, like I had this girlfriend once and she loved me, and that's all, like I just kind of hold that as a standard out here, and I just tell someone could be as good as she was. Like, I don't know that I can find the right person. And Jesus says, if you want to define love, if you want to set the standard of love, here's my command for you to love others as I have loved you. So I wonder, what would it look like if this week you could remain in Jesus? What would it look like if you could, just at a minimum, consider the teachings of Jesus and the way that he lived and the way that he loved? What would that change for you? What would you learn about Jesus, but what would you learn about yourself? And in learning about yourself and changing the way that you live, I wonder, what would that mean? Imagine with me if you could be the person that you are looking for. Be the person that the person you are looking for is looking for. How would Jesus continue to transform to help you become the person that you ultimately really want to be? It's not like you're proud of your bad habits, your addictions, or the things that you carry and the baggage that you bring into your next relationship. You're not proud of that stuff. You want freedom from those things too. You want a better way forward too. What's it look like for you to remain in Jesus, to draw your source of life from him? Now, the truth is that we could stop right here, and I'm sure there's already enough practicalities in this that we could say, I got some next steps that I could take. But you're still here, and I want to give you three tips to dating. Okay, these are real practical here. Three tips to dating. These are your notes. One is this. Never date hungry. Never date hungry. Here's what I mean by that. Hunger, it lowers your standards. Have you ever gone to a grocery store, and you've got a plan, you've got a list, you're going to meal prep, you know exactly what you want, but you're hungry? And so as you're pushing your cart through your aisles, everything just starts to look good to you, right? And you're like, oh, like I could just, if I could just eat that right now, if I could just get home, I can't wait to get home. And you've got your plan and you've got your list, but now you're starting to add in all these other things that are not on your list. So you put in the staples like meat and some veggies and bread and milk and some frozen pizza and some eggs, some cheese, maybe a carton of ice cream because, hey, you're human. You deserve it. Come on. You had a tough week. But right now you're hungry, so everything looks good. And you're adding all these other things, so here come the ding-dongs and the ho-hos into your cart, too. Never date hungry. Okay, because you'll lower your standards. You'll lower your standards. In fact, Proverbs tells this, says, keep vigilant watch over your heart. That's where life starts. Keep vigilant watch over your heart. You've got to be careful what you're putting in. You've got to be careful what you're taking in. As a 40-year-old with lowering metabolism, I have to be careful what I'm taking in, right? Because what's tasty on my lips is disaster on my hips, okay? You have to be careful of what you're bringing in. Guard yourself and guard your heart. Here's the second one is this. Find a friend, not a lover. Find a friend, not a lover. Scripture tells us that if you find a good spouse, you find a good life. And then just two verses later is all. It says this. It says, friends, they come and friends go. But a true friend sticks by you like family. And isn't that what we really want in our partner, in our person, in our spouse? Is we don't want someone to come and go. People enter and exit our lives all the time. But we want our spouse, our person that we're going to share, like we want them to be there for the long haul. That's what we desire. That's what we seek. And the reality is, in so many ways, while technology has done huge advancements and huge benefits for our culture, even in the dating world, it's benefited from technology, right? Some of you might be here today because of somebody that you met online, and that's awesome. But it's also pretty accurate to say that we live in a culture that is very much so a do what makes you happy. And so you have the internet, and apps that have brought porn and other apps that make casual sex and casual hookups and casual encounters just like kind of the norm, almost the expectation that it's just as easy as swiping right, that you can find somebody that quick. And just, it's just, oh, this makes me happy in the moment. This is what I feel like I need right now. And dating apps such as Tinder, Hinge, and OkCupid, I'm not knocking them, but they've poured gasoline on this hookup culture that we can just instantly gratify ourselves, instantly find something that we think we're looking for in the moment. Just do what makes you happy. But isn't it true? And I get there might be a time in people's life where that, I don't know, that's all I really want right now. But isn't it like really what we desire and seek is that companionship and that friendship, that ride or die, till death do us part, thick or thin, I'd bury a body with you person, you know? That's what we hope for and we desire that. Find a friend, not just a lover. The third one is this, okay, your direction determines the destination. And this might seem simple, like, duh, Tony. But direction determines the destination. In fact, back in Proverbs it says, let your eyes look straight ahead. Fix your gaze directly before you. Give careful thought to the paths for your feet and be steadfast in all your ways. Your direction, the direction that you are heading, where you're looking, the steps you are taking, it determines the destination that you end up at. And in this dating world, I think it's worth the time and energy and effort to explore, do you want the same things? And this isn't just a faith question, okay? I know you're at church today, but let's take faith off the table for a second. Just consider this very practically for a second, and just with honest and no judgment. Do you want the same things with the person? Like, do you see yourself heading, even when it comes to dating, are you casually dating or are you looking for a spouse? Are you looking for someone to partner with, right? Do you want the same or similar things for your future? Are you headed in the same direction, the picture that you have? How about kids? Not just do you want them, but how do you think you're going to parent? How do you think you're going to navigate the complexities of parenting? What about your finances? What about your priorities? What about your faith? These are things that you should consider in the direction that you're going, because your direction determines your destination. And you can avoid a lot of heartache by knowing yourself and knowing the direction that you're headed in. And you can find somebody that's heading in a similar direction. Because the truth is that there is a lot of good out there and a lot of good things going in a lot of different directions. But don't let good sabotage your great because you unified yourself or linked up with somebody that's going in a different direction. But this is good, and I could do, like, find someone that's going in your direction. You don't have to believe and follow these myths. Once you bring them to light, you're like, oh, yeah, that is pretty ridiculous. And that has informed a lot of my decisions, but it doesn't have to. You don't have to repeat the same mistakes that you've experienced. You can work on yourself, become the person that you are looking for. What would it look like for you to do that? If you're a follower of Jesus, he asks you and he asks me to remain in him as our source of life, where we draw life. And he says, obey my commands. And when you do that, this is when you experience the joy and delight of life. But it's rooted in him. It's not rooted in somebody else. We need to work on ourselves to become the person that we are looking for, ultimately, is looking for. And so you've got some steps to take. Again, if you're a follower of Jesus, what's it look like this week for you to remain in him? Maybe read your Bible. Maybe delete some apps on your phone. Maybe ask somebody, a friend, a counselor, ask for some help to get through and to get rid of some bad habits in your life. What's it look like for you to remain in him? And as we pray today, I want to pray just for the guts and the courage that God would lead us into whatever step we would take. And if you're here today and you've never made a decision to put your trust and faith in Jesus as your primary relationship, or you're watching online with us right now and you've never taken that step, this is your opportunity to say yes to Jesus, who is the best relationship and the foundation of all other relationships that you can have, to believe that God loves you and he's for you and he created you and he wants to be in relationship with you, and let that be the source of life in all of your relationships with you, that you can say yes to that today. So let's pray together. God, we pray right now that you would be obvious to each one of us, that you would, maybe we need clarity, or we already have crystal clear clarity, that there's some steps that we need to take. And for some of us right now, the step we just need to take is say yes to you, yes to you, yes to you, because we've said yes to ourselves for so long, yes to our own ways, and we've fumbled and bumbled our way through relationships in life. But God, right now we're choosing to put our trust and our faith in you. We want to follow you. Follow you, God. We choose you. God, would you forgive us for the ways that we've messed up, that we've missed the mark, that we've sinned? Each one of us, God. And would you bring us clarity on ways forward, on steps forward, to become the person that you ultimately want us to be. That our motive is to be truly just who you've designed us to be. But God, an offshoot of that or a byproduct of that is becoming the person that we're looking for is looking for, which is a win-win. Help us to work on ourselves. Help us to see the steps we need to take and to have the guts to take it today and this week. In Jesus' name, amen. Next week, we're going to talk a little bit about divorce, or a lot of it about it. And I think it's going to be really helpful. And it's going to be really honest. And so I'd encourage you, if you've ever had a friend that's struggled through some of the complexities of divorce, especially when it relates to the church too, because I know there's some layers there, I'd encourage you to invite someone to come along with you. I think it'll be a really beneficial week for all of us. Before we wrap up, before Rachel comes up, would you go ahead and watch this? Hey, Eastpoint, Tony here, and right now I'm in part of our building that some of you don't even know exists. But before I tell you where I am, I want to tell you about two different ways that you can be making a difference. The first one is that this summer in August of 2024, we're going to be taking a team to the Dominican Republic. We're going to be partnering with Living Water, which is an organization that we actually already partner with because we believe in bringing clean water to developing nations. And so this is your chance to join the team. In just 2 weeks, we're going to have a meeting on March 17th, right after service, to be able to put the information in your hands, answer any questions you have, and give you the chance to say, hey, I'm in, I want to join the team, and head over to the Dominican Republic this summer. The second thing is this, and this involves where we're at in the building right now. In fact, I want to show you the room a little bit. Come follow me a little bit here. You'll notice there's kids clothing around me, for boys, for girls. Actually, there's clothing around in here for all ages. Everything from birth up to youth, and even some adult clothing as well. This room is called our foster closet. And this room, every single week, and you might not know this, but this room, because of you, because of donations that you make, because of what we get to do as a church, this room is making a difference in the lives of families who have stepped up and said, hey, we want to be part of the foster system. We want to take in kids when they don't have a place to go and a home to go to and be able to raise them up, show them love and show them values and share Christ with them in our homes. And so each week, we get the chance to bring families in here and they get to shop. They get to find items that they need for the ages and stages of kids that they're bringing into their home. And right now, actually for all of March, we're doing a sock, underwear, it's a lot here, okay? Sock, underwear, diaper, wipes, drive. Here they are actually in person. I got socks, I got underwear, diapers, and wipes. And we're doing a drive all month long, and we want you to participate. These socks, underwear, diapers, wipes, these are like the most basic needs that every family needs to provide for their kids. And when a family gets a new placement for them, or that they're at a spot where they just need something, they can show up here, they can shop around, and we want to be able to always provide their most basic needs of what they have. So more than just the clothes, but these are just the essentials of what you needed when you raised your kids or when you have kids in your home. And we want to be able to provide these for foster families in need at any point, at any moment's notice. So all month long, bring your donations. There's a box in the lobby you can drop these things off at. Again, socks, underwear, diaper, wipes from kids, everything from newborn babies all the way up to youth-age kids. So thanks for the way that you're going to participate because it's making a difference. Oops. So stupid now. Oops, one more thing. All these items, they need to be new. We don't want your used undies showing up, okay? Bring some new items to help foster families in need. Thanks.
It's dumb. But like Tony said, we're excited to partner with the foster closet that we have happening here. And we have people coming every single week. It is being utilized. And we'd love for you to partner with our foster closet team. And so all month long, like Tony said, this is our initiative. Socks, underwear, diapers, wipes, not used. And there's a box in the lobby that you can donate to. And it's here every Sunday and midweek if you want to stop by and make a donation. But we're excited for what's happening in the foster closet and the ways that you can participate through generosity that way. If you today decided to make Jesus the Lord and leader of your life, we have these gifts for you. They're by the doors on your way out. They're new believer boxes. And they just have tools to help you get started in your journey of faith. We want to partner with you as you take this exciting next step. And if you made this decision today, would you come find me? I want to celebrate with you and help you get started on this journey. Hey, if you came prepared to give, we're going to put some ways to give up on the screen there. Thank you so much for those of you who partner with us and so generously give so that we can be a safe place for people to find and follow Jesus. And if you're a guest here this morning, please take a pass on that. We're just thrilled to have you here with us. Now, would you all stand with me? We're getting ready to head out, and I just want to direct your attention to the blue bins by the doors. If you want to drop off your programs that you don't want to take home, message notes, pens, you can put all of those things in there. Otherwise, we will see you next week for one service under one roof. Invite a friend to join you as we continue and wrap up this series for better or for worse. We'll see you then.
Take rest, cause the living God is living in my chest. Every day I wake up feeling blessed, and even if I don't, I see it as a test. Cause I was lost until you found me. Now I know you're all around me. Nothing I could ever do separate my love from you. You came to set us free.
You came to set us free.
So I won't worry. To wake me up from waiting. Do I mean it when I'm praying just to pray to see you move the mountain somehow? I don't want another way to move among the mirrors I'm protecting. And I'm never really claiming all the grace it takes to make a way with you out. I'm giving in. I'm giving in. Standing in the river of my second guesses. Don't believe it when I'm praying, too afraid to pray and stir the water somehow. Never really been okay to move among the whispers, never resting. Is there any other way to make the space it takes to break away with you now? I'm giving in. I'm giving in. I'm ready to back down. Hallelujah, hallelujah, holy moments with you, I'm settling in.